My name is Robin Wordsworth.
Okay, and what do you do? What are you an expert in?
I am an expert in planetary climate and climate evolution. And so I work on questions like, why does early Mars have evidence for liquid water? What are the potential climates of exoplanets that we're going to be able to observe in the near future?
Okay.
And what's the chance that the life could have existed on other worlds?
Okay, well, that's exactly my next question. Are we alone?
Are we alone? That is a... in the sense you obviously mean of existence of other life in the outside of Earth. I think for me personally, the only intellectually honest answer I can give to that is that I just don't know. And I think that's an exciting answer because it means that we as scientists have a job to do to try to figure out whether or not there is life out there. And so it's, I think it's easy to have an emotional reaction and to have a like strong desire for something to be the case one way or the other, but based on my best understanding of the science, it's not possible to say at this point if life on Earth is unique or if there is life elsewhere. And of course the question of alone, I think you also have to define the context. So is life on Earth unique in the solar system, or is it unique in the sense that in our stellar neighborhood, there are no other Earth-like planets? Or if we go across the entire galaxy, would we either be likely to find an Earth-like world? And so there are different levels to that question.
How is your research going to help us find life elsewhere?
So I'm a planetary scientist primarily. I like astrobiology a lot, and I work on topics that overlap into astrobiology, but my core focus is on planetary science and not on the search for life per se. And so I guess what I would say to that is that as a planetary scientist, I regard the basic planetary conditions as the building block for understanding anything about whether you can sustain or develop life on other worlds. And so we want to know the context under which life may or may not develop. And both in terms of in the solar system, trying to understand things like the evolution of Mars through time, where, well, Mars and Venus and Earth, where in paleoclimate, it's basically a detective story. You have a crime scene of evidence of things that have happened, and you have to piece together a self-consistent story from that. And then on the other side of what we work on a lot, which is exoplanets, it's operation, in theory and modeling at least, in predictive mode right now, where we make statements based on generalized models we developed that are based on constraints in the solar system, and then try and say for a given exoplanet, what's the probability that it has sustainable liquid water or chemical conditions that are sufficient for life to develop, or signatures in its atmosphere which may or may not convolve with biosignatures or like allow us to easily detect life or make that more difficult.
What do you think of the usefulness of the Lovelock criterion of an atmosphere in chemical disequilibrium as a biosignature?
Yeah, so I think it's one of those great and powerful concepts that's in some ways too powerful because it's such a simple idea, and it's rightly guided thinking for a long time on this issue, but when you really break it down, there are multiple ways in which it can diverge or go wrong. And so I think it's a great guiding principle, but what we've seen in our own research is that there are definitely other ways you can get atmospheres in chemical disequilibrium.
Like volcanism?
Well, most obviously. So if you take a gas of a given composition and you heat it up enough, then the chemical reaction rates will eventually proceed fast enough that in a timescale that you're interested in, everything will proceed to minimize Gibbs free energy, and you'll get thermochemical equilibrium. And then so Lovelock's essential argument is that systems naturally drive towards equilibrium and life drives away from it. And so because we're seeing life's waste products in the atmosphere, essentially, that allows us to make that detection. But then the thing is, for any planetary atmosphere, even in the absence of life, you're not dealing with a system in equilibrium. You have an atmosphere which is in chemical contact with the interior. You have outgassing and you have exchange with rocks, but sometimes the timescales for that are very long. And then on the other side, you have input of solar energy and UV photons in particular, which drive things far out of equilibrium. And so a planet with no life whatsoever, with just UV photons impinging at the top and volcanism at the bottom, will ultimately drive out of equilibrium. And so the sort of broad Lovelockian principle, if you want to put it like that, we should look for signs of chemical disequilibrium. It's a great general concept, but it breaks down in detail. And when that breakdown happens, at least so far, the way that the biosignatures debate has had to proceed is that you just model things using models, complex models, and try and figure out for a given scenario that you've created whether you were to see a biosignature or not. And that's as good a method as we have right now, but the issue with it is that you then become dependent on the fidelity of your complex model and the extent to which we're able to imagine all the possible scenarios where you could get life or not.